Hey, it's Luminosic. Welcome back to another video. We've done a little bit of diversion on this channel lately from the plant medicine topic. Although, you know, it's not necessarily what this channel is about. It's more about the gnosis and consciousness. But for me, a big part of that is plant medicine. And anyways, we got into some other topics. If you didn't see any of those videos, I would encourage you to check them out because it all kind of does relate back. It's kind of part of my style to weave these big webs and then bring it all back together. So I do encourage you to watch all of the videos because they're basically all bits and pieces of a larger framework, and the more of it you see, the more value you will get out of it. The same goes for the videos. Watch them all the way through because I have a tendency to kind of go out in these different streams of consciousness, and then I'll bring it all back together at the end. And so you're definitely going to get a lot more value out of the videos if you watch them all the way through. So please hit the like button, share the videos with anyone you think might like them, and subscribe. Support us on Patreon if possible. You can click the link below. Also, you know, engaging, we really encourage that. So, you know, drop a comment, let me know if there's a topic you'd like covered, or, you know, ask any questions you'd like, and I'll do my best to address them. Okay, so the topic of today's video, back to the plant medicine, is the effects of San Pedro. I had a couple of people request more in-depth journey report, and so I decided to go ahead and try to do that. Somebody was asking about the physical sensation. I don't want to talk about that too much because I kind of feel like it's irrelevant, for one thing. And I just don't really notice much of anything. I mean, for me, with all plant medicine, and, you know, even LSD, there's like a transitional period where you feel a little bit of discomfort, maybe a lot of discomfort, might vomit. You know, it's like you're moving into a different reality tunnel, so it's almost like birth pains or something. I mean, but yeah, I mean, you know, you'll feel some anxiousness, some, you might feel lethargic, need to lay down. I usually lay down until the medicine starts working, and then, you know, eventually, for me, you know, the way I think about it is that it's not so much that you're, it's like you're just waiting for the physical sensation to be gone, and then you feel like you always would, except that you're on this journey. So I mean, maybe a little bit more energy, but for the most part, for me, there's not really, you know, any kind of physical sensation that is like worthy of discussion. So, you know, other than the initial discomfort phase, which might last for about an hour, it's really nothing to talk about. Okay, so as far as the other effects, the actual journey, I had a very interesting experience a little while back with a very high dose of San Pedro. I actually may have even lost consciousness a little bit, it sounds like, which is not normal for me. I'm usually, you know, able to maintain focus pretty well. And I was overwhelmed for probably about an hour on this occasion. Another reason that I want to talk about this particular experience is that some other people that I've given this cactus to had the same exact experience. So I think it might be something that's fairly consistent with San Pedro journeys to have this experience. And basically what happened is that I became like a fragment, like a photon of consciousness in a sea of consciousness. And, you know, I've met San Pedro shamans that have talked about how, you know, having a really deep experience of San Pedro cactus is like becoming part of the light in a way that's conscious. You know, we're always part of the light. We are the light. We are made of the light. Our consciousness is just generated by light. You know, there's really nothing in the universe except for light and darkness. You know, all matter is light in a standing wave. And so, you know, and people have argued with me and said, well, no, there's also sound, you know, but that is, again, anything that's vibrating has a physical basis, and therefore it's still just light. So you're basically arguing, you know, that no, there's also light if you're saying that. So that's not really a relevant argument. There are two things in the universe, light and darkness, fundamentally. And so, a little bit of a digression there, but, so I became like this little tiny particle of light, and I realized that, you know, this idea of macrocosm, microcosm, from, you know, Jewish mysticism and probably other schools of the occult. I know there's a lot of overlap in these fundamental ideas about how the universe works, in the metaphysical arena from different schools of thought. So what I realized is that there's not really any difference between being like a single photon in a sea of light and a universe in a sea of universes. That, you know, the San Pedro is basically explaining to me, you could think about this any way that you want to. this is you as a tiny little individual in this sea of possibility, or this is a photon of light, or this is the universe that you're in relative to all the other universes in the multiverse. And every one of them represents some kind of potentiality. Some of them actualized already, depending on their, like, it's like, here's the timeline, you know, and it actually runs in every direction at once. And, you know, it was a lot to process. Also, I think I should talk about these individual units. I noticed that I could zoom in on them and I could, like, move them around and look at them from different angles and sort of examine. And I could, like, put them all back out. And then there was, like, a geometry that was represented in the macro as well as by the individual units. And so yeah, it's really shifting. I can't remember what they're called, the shapes that exist in 4D, so they're also in a dimension of time, so you can't see them all at once. You know, that might be a good way to kind of think about these things. But at any rate, the next thing that the cactus told me is that there are, you know, you experience the world in 3D, 4D, whatever, maybe 5D if you're illuminated enough. But, you know, there's actually this infinite sea of dimensions, not just possibilities and experience, but actually dimensions. And this was extremely difficult to wrap the head around because, you know, it's like, what does that mean experientially? Like, how do you interpret that in a way that tells you something comprehensible? And the value, part of the value of taking the medicine is that when you're looking at it, you can see it. Having to try to articulate it is an entirely different thing. But the best way that I can explain it is that it said, you know, look at all of these trillions. I mean, trillions. That's one of the things this cactus does that is unique. I think it breaks everything down into these tiny, tiny, tiny segments. Much more so than, you know, when you see like psilocybin hallucinations or ayahuasca tends to be very macro for me. Like they're just big images, you know, like cartoons or spirit beings around in a circle, whatever. With mushrooms, there's like a film over everything. That's all these little dots of color, LSD as well. With this particular cactus, it's like very tiny, highly detailed. You know, that's kind of a normal characteristic of San Pedro. So at any rate, it was showing me all of these tiny little trillions of particles, and it said that, you know, for every relationship between one of these particles and another particle, there's actually a dimension that, you know, as you evolve in consciousness, eventually what it will mean to be fully aware is that you will experience things in this many dimensions. And, you know, I can't claim to have wrapped my head around what that means, but, you know, that's the information that I was given. And looking at it, I could see, you know, how it was possible. But, again, you know, I mean, I don't think we have the capacity to really fully understand what that means. But then it showed me something else. It said, here's a timeline. Here's where you exist. This little particle is you. And I watched this. And it just, like, it took one of the other particles out, and I ceased to exist. And that experience was absolutely horrible. Of course, it's, you know, a very subjective, difficult to explain, but it's not like, you know, I was in clear light all of a sudden or that I was in darkness. I was just not there anymore, and then suddenly I was back again. So that was a tremendously weird and awful experience. And so when I came back to consciousness, you know, I just kind of had this understanding of, like, how fragile and how improbabilistic our existence was. And of course, getting to actually experience it and have it taken away in a way that seems so real and then suddenly come back, I mean, that was a valuable experience on a tremendous amount of levels. And so when it showed me this, I asked, you know, so does this mean that this was all you know, like there's no divine intelligence, it's just a random, that the universe is just a chance happening? And it said, no, absolutely not. In fact, what I'm showing you is a demonstration of the opposite. How organized and how well directed and perfect the intelligence is that actually constructs these realities. So that was from the first experience, and I'm going to talk a little bit about an experience I had I think maybe a couple of weeks after that. It may have even been before, I don't know, it doesn't really matter, the timeline doesn't really matter. This idea that different psychedelics bring down filters that screen out different aspects of reality, And that one of the benefits of this is that there is a veil between us and the spirit world. And you can bring that veil down and you can have direct communiques with spiritual beings. And, you know, a lot of people would say that, you know, with San Pedro, that is the spirit that you're in communication with, whatever the intelligence of the cactus. You know, a lot of people feel that way about mushrooms and DMT and certainly ayahuasca. But I think it's also possible to make contact with intelligence of a totally different order and even like the most high. And I found out kind of the hard way that, you know, it's an old magical cliche that you don't bring an impure offering before the altar of the Most High. And this serves to elucidate what can happen if you're not really conducting yourself in a way that the spirits on the plant medicine approve of, how you might be corrected. And it can be pretty terrifying. So a little bit of background on this. You know, at the time I had been, I'm a musician, and I used the Lucifer myth a lot to sort of, make points in the music. It's got nothing to do with darkness or evil. In fact, it's sort of like painting the Lucifer archetype in as sort of a Promethean light. The way that the, you know, serpent encouraged them to go after knowledge in the Garden of Eden by eating of the tree. So at any rate, you know, back in North America, people would understand, you know, what it was that I was communicating and not take it the wrong way. But I had been down here in South America where, you know, a lot of people don't speak English. They're watching me perform. The only thing they really hear is all these references to the devil. And so I'm also, you know, associated with plant medicine in the area. So I've been going out and performing this and also, you know, drinking a little bit on stage and stuff. And so my girlfriend and I go up on top of the mountain and we drink the San Pedro. And she made a comment about how she was bored, and it kind of irritated me. So I kind of muttered, Gran Espiritu, great spirit. And as soon as I said that, you know, and this is something that, you know, in a shamanic practice, you know, that in any magical practice, that words have power, and that when you utter something like that, you had better make sure that, you know, why you're doing it, that you have your energy under control. You know, there's a lot of things to consider before, you know, invoking a name of great power like that. And as soon as I did it, all of the cows in the area, they were like falling over themselves trying to get away, like tripping over their feet. Enormous ruckus. The air went ice cold. My girlfriend, I don't know how she even ended up outside of the tent. The next thing that I noticed is that there's these cords, like whoosh, like they very difficult to describe. I mean, they were energetic, you know. It was not like I perceived them as having an absolute physical basis, but you also had the sense that they could actually do you real physical harm if they were to touch you. I remember at one point one sort of whipped right by my neck, and I felt like, you know, it could have just taken my head off. And there was this feeling of tremendous power, like something of tremendous power had arrived, and I recognized this immediately as the energy of the Father. When people talk about, you know, the Father in these terms of like respect and like this like fear, it's like a certain aspect or archetype of like the Father energy. And so, so it had these cords, and I mean, I saw them fly out like one after the other out into the bushes, and I saw like the leaves fly off the bushes as they rip through. And so I was just very still, trying to get my energy under control. And every now and then I would feel one of these, like, cords sort of tensed. And when that happened, my girlfriend would scream, you know. And I started to kind of grovel. And I'm like, no, just don't hurt the girl, you know. And the presence is like, don't grovel, you know. And I was, like, looking at these lines. And I remember I had the thought, no lines have been crossed. Like, no one's actually hurt. Like, there hasn't been any real irreversible damage done. This thing is just trying to make a point. And then it told me, like, what if I was actually, instead of the Great Spirit just coming to teach you a lesson, a bunch of, like, local conservative farmers that heard that maybe there was, like, this, you know, dark shaman that had arrived from the United States singing this music and, you know, what kind of attention are you attracting? Like, what is it that you're doing? You know, if you're going to be an avatar for these plant spirits and represent the community of beings that we represent, you know, and the community of humans that are involved with this thing, you need to really think about how you're conducting yourself publicly and blah, blah, blah. So the point is that, you know, even though it came and terrified us, you know, absolutely to death, it was really just making a point that, you know, you need to conduct yourself, you know, along certain lines and, you know, get it under completely under control. Some of the things that you've been doing lately have not been, you haven't been thinking this through. And so, you know, that was the gist of it. And my girlfriend did perceive the presence a little bit differently, but she spoke of it as like an alien presence. And, you know, I don't want to get into her personal stuff, and I think that I could analyze all of that, but I don't know that it's appropriate to do so. So yeah, this was a part of our experience with contact with the Great Spirit via the cactus. And it was really, you know, just trying to make a lesson, trying to drive a point home. It's an indescribably powerful experience to be in the presence of something that you consider to be a spiritual being that you, it was almost like being surrounded by people with guns, you know, like I had no doubt that this thing was bigger than us, more powerful than us. It could turn our life force off like it had a switch on it, you know, but it's not like I actually thought that it was going to do that. I sensed the benignity, but I knew that it was angry. So it was just a tremendously powerful experience, and, definitely had, you know, some impact on both of us. And actually, a really funny thing happened a little bit later. You know, all the animals scattered when this presence arrived. The donkey Pepino that we'd used to carry all of our stuff up to the top of the mountain actually came down the hill and peered in. There's like a little window in the tent, and it like peered in to see if we were okay. And when it saw we were okay, it like did this little jump and like made a sound and ran off, you know, like, whew, thank God you guys are all right, you know, because I wasn't really sure after Great Spirit showed up and, you know, that reprimand. was a bit on the terrifying side. So, I guess that's the story of the potential for contact with the other side of the veil with San Pedro. And, you know, I think I should also say that I've been very skeptical about whether that aspect of plant medicine was real. You know, is Pachamama really like a non-human ancient intelligence of high, or yeah, ancient intelligence of very high intelligence, or is it just some activated capacity of the human brain that, you know, we're not normally engaged with? And, you know, over time, the experiences that I've had have demonstrated to me that, you know, and it does seem more likely than not, from my point of view, that these are actual, you know, spiritual intelligences. I should also say that saying that they're separate from us, I'm not entirely convinced of that either. You know, the hermetic idea that the universe is a gigantic mind, and that, you know, even when these things are embodied, like, you know, Terrence McKenna used to say this about the UFO phenomenon, that he didn't really think that they were UFOs. They were just, you know, like a projection of some archetypal part of ourselves. So it very well could be that, you know, San Pedro and ayahuasca are that. But at the moment, I'm definitely leaning more towards the idea that they are some sort of external plant intelligence. So thanks a lot for watching. Hit the like button, subscribe. Donate on Patreon. We're really trying to get down to the jungle so we can spend some time with the Shuar, document all that. And also the money that we raise is going to go to help buy land so that the Chinese Mayans can't destroy it anymore. The next video will probably be something along the lines of, you know, what the different plant medicines are used for, you know, because every one of them has some different application. Where they're better suited to treat like certain types of mental illness or certain types of trauma, or, you know, to get over something from the past and move forward, you know, a catalyst, I guess, for growth rather than actually healing trauma. So we're going to get into all that. Thanks a lot for watching.